Hello, this is City Council Spotlight, today with Ward 1 Councilor Matt McLaughlin. I'm Sarah Fishman. How are you doing, Matt?
Doing all right. How's it going?
Okay. Yeah. Do you have a good New Year?
I had a great New Year, yep. Great Christmas time as well, so looking forward to getting back to work.
Okay, so now your work is going to be a little different this time because you are no longer president of the council. We'll get to that. But first of all, let's hop on the Green Line. So now finally opened, and you're, I guess, somewhat close at least to one of the stops. Have you been on? What do you think of the service?
Yeah, I've only been on once because I'm actually live right next door to the Sullivan Square Orange Line station, so that's my easiest train line to access. But my wife and son and I took a trip on the Green Line extension just to go from east to West Somerville. My mother lives in West Somerville, so we hopped on the train and took the train to my mother's house and back. So it was an interesting experience. It's interesting just to see, like, you know, it's been something that people have been waiting 30 years for, and every time people say it's almost done, I'd always say, well, I'll wait and see when it's actually complete. Mm-hmm. So now that it's done, it's just really interesting to experience, and I kind of view my use of the Green Line more than anything is going to be east to West Somerville, as opposed to going into Boston, which a lot of people are going to use it for.
So did you grow up in West Somerville?
I grew up right outside of Davis Square, yeah. Okay. My whole family lived there, and then I moved to East Somerville probably early 2000s or late 2000s.
Okay, so yeah. I have the East Somerville stop pin, which I received actually at the Ball Square stop.
All right.
When the city had its party on opening day, which was a little over a month ago. But I have a question about access. So I have taken the train a couple of times. The East Somerville stop, I haven't got off, but I can't see where people can easily access it. Is it safe? Is there a big street you have to cross? It seems like it's kind of in the middle of...
Yeah, so it's an issue. It's definitely an issue. First of all, the East Somerville stop, the actual entrance is on the Union Square side. So you have to walk down this really long path to get to the East Somerville stop. And the reason that is because there's also commuter rail and industrial rail lines that the Green Line follows along. So they couldn't figure out a way to get people safely across those train tracks to get to the East Somerville train stop. So right now I've had a few people reach out to me about safety concerns. They want safety boxes down there, better lighting, security cameras to make sure nothing happens down there. And then the intersection itself, I've been fighting for several years now to make sure the state follows through on a promise to have a stoplight there.
Where exactly?
This is on the Tufts and Washington intersection, okay, which is where most people coming and going from the Green Line are going to cross that street. And we finally got it repainted by the state just a few weeks ago, right before they opened the station. But I think it needs its own stoplight so that traffic actually comes to a complete stop.
That's really, yeah. It's really scary, the turn, it goes.
People are coming under the bridge there, so they're not really paying attention. And then Tufts Street is a two-lane street that's pretty wide, and people speed down that. So it's been a problem intersection for a while, and the state says they're going to address it. But the issue of the stoplight's the biggest issue to me, because it went from this is happening to we have to study if this is possible. And for me, it's a necessity, especially if you want people to walk and bike and take the T. They're going to have to cross this basically a highway, because a lot of people also are coming and going from I-93, McGrath Highway, so they treat it like it's a highway. Mm-hmm. So we need to slow down the traffic there.
Mm-hmm. So you posted something about wishing for the bike path extension,
yes,
to open. So now the bike path has been extended to Lowell Street, where the first of the GLX stops is, the Magoon Square stop. So is it gonna now go from Lowell all the way to East Somerville? Is that
That's the plan, yeah. It's already built, and the city is basically waiting to finalize a lease agreement with the state so that we take control over the bike trail and the responsibility of maintenance of the trail. So once that's signed and agreed upon, then the trail will be open to everybody.
So is it that big bridge? Does the path go... There's like a bridge that's separate from where the train tracks are?
Going towards Leachmere, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, that's part of it. And that's going to be, it's going to be interesting to ride over that.
It looks a little scary.
I haven't been on it yet, so I'll wait and see.
There's nothing on either side, really. I mean, there's fencing, obviously, but it's not right next to tracks or buildings.
I haven't been on it, so yeah. I'll wait and see, but I'm sure it's going to be safer than riding on the street.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you know when the extension's going to open?
Hopefully, I think they said the end of this month, but again, it depends on the lease agreement with the state.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is not a news story, but gentrification and displacement. The Green Line comes, more people have access to transit, but property values go up, people are pushed out. Do you have any strong feeling how this can be managed or managed better than it is now? I know it's a huge question.
Yeah. Well, I think it's interesting that the word gentrification is finally allowed to be used in the city now that the Green Line is actually here, because people like myself for years were talking about gentrification and displacement in relation to public transportation, that, you know, apparently you can't have your cake and eat it too in this country, because once things turn nice, it becomes unaffordable. And when I was coming up talking about this, people discouraged us from using the word gentrification.
Why?
Because it offends the gentry and makes it an us against them sort of thing, which I agree that shouldn't be the case, but it is happening. And to argue over the word isn't as important to me as addressing the problem. So I think this has been a problem, a very foreseeable problem for a long time. And only now that the Green Line is finally here, do I see headlines about, will the Green Line bring gentrification? It's like, we've known this for decades. It's already happened.
Right.
The gentrification's already happened. So people talk about, will this happen? It's like, it's already happened based on the speculation of the Green Line alone. So most of the people I grew up with, they don't live in the city anymore. I deal with every few years, a third or a quarter of my population move somewhere else.
From your ward?
Yeah, from my ward. About a quarter to a third of all residents move every 2 to 4 years. And that's, I know Union Square is even more so than that. But yeah, there's a lot of turnover, and a large part of that has to be because of the rents and the affordability issues. So it's been an issue. The city is working to address a lot of affordable housing issues. We talked about that last night at the midterm. And it's just not enough yet. And, you know, a lot of it is, some of it is unavoidable. But other parts are, you know, I wish we took this more seriously from the beginning. So one of the things that I'm trying to do is, we have all these new Green Line stops that are going to make everything around it completely unaffordable. We have developers who are desperate to build next to these Green Line stops. We have 20% inclusionary housing rate, which is the highest affordable housing rate in the state. So if you want to build X amount of units, 20% of them have to be affordable. What we have is places like Ball Square is the best example I have, where you have 20% affordable rate, but you're only allowed to build three or four stories there. So no developer is going to build at a 20% rate if they can only build four stories. And it also goes against a lot of city planning models of density near transit. So what I'm trying to propose, hopefully this year we'll get it done, is density bonuses, height bonuses for development. So if you have a four-story building, maybe you could build five or six stories and maybe build it at 25%.
So is it specific to the neighborhood? Because in Union Square, those buildings are very tall.
Yeah. Well, Union has already happened to a dramatic extent.
Is the zoning different in Union than?
Yes, okay. It's ridiculously lopsided, where Union Square has 20-story buildings and Ball Square only has three or four. And if you go down there, most of those buildings are only one story right now.
Right.
So it's also, that's another issue of the equity of development in the city, where all the major development, all the large scale development is happening in the east side of town, and the west side really has downzoned units, and they're benefiting greatly from the Green Line extension, but there's not really much as far as building affordable housing happening in those neighborhoods.
It's so complicated.
Yeah.
There's so many moving parts. You made reference to last night. So last night the mayor gave her midterm address, and the new city council president, he spoke also about these issues. And I believe there's more money in the current budget for some tools, more tools, more funds to address this. Is there anything that the mayor mentioned or that is new to the budget that you're particularly happy is there because it'll address these issues? And or is there something missing? Is there some big thing that's missing other than what you've just said?
Well, one thing that's unrelated to affordable housing that I was very happy the mayor talked about was safe consumption sites. She publicly supported the idea and said, we're going to try to be the first city in the state to do that. So I was very happy to hear her commit to that. Things around affordable housing, we have put a lot of money into affordable housing, $8 million this last year to the Affordable Housing Trust to buy affordable housing quickly and convert, like buy regular housing, convert it into affordable housing. We do a lot around stipends for housing, housing vouchers for people.
Isn't there a new voucher program?
Yeah, we have a new voucher program, which is different than federal state voucher programs. So more people will be able to access it than under state and federal guidelines. And then she also talked about universal,
universal basic income.
Universal basic income, which I haven't seen her plan yet, but that sounds really interesting. So I think we're doing a lot as far as putting our money where our mouth is in terms of affordable housing. Unfortunately, we just don't have enough money. Like, even a city that has a lot of money, like Somerville, doesn't have enough to truly address affordable housing, which is why I'd like to see these private developers who are going to benefit from the Green Line, who are going to benefit from doing business in the city, get them to contribute more to affordable housing as well.
So I don't want to beat you up on this because there's no one single thing that's going to. But I don't know if you saw the editorial in the Globe this morning. It was about Michelle Wu and her plans for addressing this in the city of Boston. And one of the things that the Globe took issue with was a proposal from Wu's administration to increase linkage fees and have a specific increase that applied only to lab spaces.
Yeah.
So the Globe was saying that's counterintuitive, that if anything, lab construction is slowed and you don't want to, you know, further suppress it. So what do you think of things like that? Increasing fees like that, should they be specific to an industry?
Well, we have linkage fees in Somerville,
right.
So I don't know Michelle Wu's plan, but it sounds like they're dealing with the same issues we are. And we have linkage fees in Somerville that are very high, and developers can't wait to build here. So people are talking about increasing those linkage fees. I have to look at the numbers on it, but I generally support it as long as, you know, if they're able to do business and want to come here and can pay the linkage fees, then that's good for everybody.
But what about targeting a specific industry? Because, I mean, we have Greentown Labs. We have tons of places. Do we want to encourage that, discourage that, be neutral in our policy?
I just see, especially, you know, when people talked about the transfer tax for real estate transactions for affordable housing, people said, oh, it'll slow down the market, it'll do this and that. It's, first of all, it never happened, unfortunately. But I'm not sure that's really true. That, you know, a linkage fee would stop lab space from wanting to come to the region that has the most college universities
in
the country. Right. It's like there's a reason they're here. Cambridge has very high linkage fees. People are desperate to build lab space there. And after our zoning was passed, we're facing this this interesting dilemma now of a lot of lab spaces want to come to Somerville and they want to build lab space instead of housing. So it was an unexpected consequence that now we have this abundance of interest in lab space.
Including the interest of future British monarchs because Prince William and Kate came to Greentown.
Yeah, so things like that. It's like Greentown Labs isn't going to leave because of high linkage fees, and they're already here anyways. And I don't think... So I don't want to say, you know, target a specific industry, but I think the Globe is a very business-friendly newspaper. And, you know, they're a newspaper that's suddenly running articles about, oh, is the Green Line going to cause gentrification? It's like, where were these headlines a decade ago? Mm. So I'm not sure how much weight I'd put into that.
Okay, let's switch gears a little. Talk about your past presidency. So you were president of the city council for how many years?
I was for 3 years. Yep.
So is a new person chosen each year?
Yeah, a new person is elected each year.
And there's also a vice president.
Yes.
So, and does the current vice president usually become the president, or is it more?
It really depends. So before I was on the council, they had a tradition of basically every year they would rotate. And then when I got on the council, everyone seemed to want Bill White to be the president because of his experience. So he was president for, I think, 5 years consecutively when I was on the council. And then Catiana Ballantyne, our present mayor, was president for 2 years, and I was her vice president for 2 years. So then when she stepped down, I became president, and Ben Ewen-Campen was the vice president.
And he's now
Mary Jo Rossetti and then Ben Ewen-Campen.
Okay,
yeah.
And Ben is now the new president.
So the vice president is kind of the heir apparent, but isn't always necessarily the case. Every year, we have a new decision.
It isn't necessarily apparent who the heir apparent is.
Yeah, exactly,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so was it more work to be president than a regular counselor?
I'd say, you know, for being a ward counselor, it's more work because as a ward counselor, I get to just focus on the 10,000 people in my neighborhood and not have to worry about other aspects of the city. So as president, I had to worry about the city as a whole and I had to worry about, you know, managing the city council itself. So it was more work, but it was definitely worthwhile.
So does the president get paid more?
Yeah, we get paid $5,000 more than
so
the rest
of the
council.
So what is the base salary?
Base salary is $40,000, so president would get $45,000.
Okay. Does that strike you as a good number?
I think it's fine. It works for me. When I got into office, it was $25,000 a year.
It and really then, jumped at one point.
Yeah, they did a study, a staffing study of all city staff, and decided that the city council should get paid more. So they jumped from 25 to 40. And for me,
several years ago?
It's four or five years ago at this point. And it's one of the higher salaries for city councils in the state. So I don't have a problem with it.
So now you're also a new father.
Yes.
You have a son who is 17 months.
Yep, yep.
So this will give you also a little more time with him?
Well, it gave me more time, and that wasn't the reason for stepping down. It was all like, I just don't think the seat was meant for someone to keep permanently. And I was also looking forward to, I was planning on stepping down last year, but a lot of people on the council asked me to stay on for another year because there were 5 new councilors. So I stuck around for another year and gladly turned it over to Ben. And, you know, I'll have more time with my son, but having a kid, having a job also just teaches you time management. So you learn to prioritize what's important.
Now, your son's name is?
William.
William.
No. William Yosemite McLaughlin.
Okay, so Yosemite is your child's middle
it's
name.
It's his
middle
name.
Because
Yosemite National Park's one of my favorite places on earth, and I love national parks, and I'm hoping to instill those values in him, so take him to a lot of national
this
parks.
It's really cool as a Somerville born and bred dude to have that part of your that thinking, part of your child raising.
Exactly. Well, I grew up a city guy. My father and mother were city people, and we, at a young age, we got out of the city and went to the White Mountains in New Hampshire and went camping, and that instilled a love of nature in me. So I think living in the city makes me love nature even more because I don't get to experience it as much. So I went to Yosemite years ago and just blew my mind what is on this planet. And I went, I think, 5 times at this point. So we were looking for a middle name that had meaning. And I said, you know, Yosemite is a place that has meaning to me. And I hope when my son asked me, why do I have such a funny middle name? I'll be really like, well, it's because, you know, this is what's important. These are our values.
Yeah, be careful of that because my son always asked that too.
Yeah.
And it wasn't quite as meaningful and he didn't like it. And that often happens.
Yeah, so. Exactly. So.
Yeah. Well, at least you have a good story.
It's a good story. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so let's switch gears again, talk about charter reform.
Yes.
And this has been a process that's been going on for a while. So we have now a strong mayor form of government, meaning what it sounds like, city council can make budget cuts, right? But they can't propose items to be included in the budget. So is there anything you would like to see, any single thing you would most like to see changed in the structure of the city's government?
Yeah, well, there were 4 things that I outlined.
Okay.
And unfortunately, all of those four things are in the current proposal for charter reform. And to be clear, is we'll still have a strong mayor form of government. Most cities in the state are either strong mayor or city manager, or city manager, which is
like
also
Cambridge.
A very strong executive branch.
Right.
So my goal is to have a little more balance and to give a little more meaning to the city council, because it's very frustrating when you're on a governing body or you're on the legislative body and you pass an ordinance and that ordinance doesn't get enforced, or you make a cut and that cut doesn't stick, things like this. So there's four things in it that I think are gonna be really beneficial to the city. There's one, we'll have our own independent auditor for budget season, which doesn't happen in Somerville right now. Most cities in Massachusetts have this, an independent auditor to look at our budget. Right now we have a city auditor reviewing the city budget, so you can see the problem with that. So that's one big change that's gonna happen. We're gonna have the city council is responsible for confirming appointments, and in the past we've learned that, you know, if we reject an appointment, it doesn't necessarily mean that appointment is gonna be rejected. The mayor can keep that position indefinitely until they find a replacement, so that'll change so that we can have a little bit more of a timeline on what's going to happen if this appointment is approved or rejected.
So is it still the mayor who's approving it, or is the city council?
The mayor is making the appointment and the city council approves or rejects it.
Okay.
And so that'll stay the same, but there'll be more guidelines about what would happen if an appointment was rejected. So something like planning board, zoning board, things like this have been contentious in the past, and we'll have more guidelines on that. We'll also have our own availability for legal counsel. It'll be very limited, but right now, if we have a difference of opinion with the mayor's office, we both go to the same lawyer, which is the city solicitor's office, and we're both expected to get a fair opinion from the person who works for the mayor.
And doesn't the school committee have?
They do, yeah. So we're looking for the same thing the school committee has.
Yes.
And then what was the fourth one? Those are three big ones. And then the budget itself too is just knowing that, you know, if say there's been times in the past where we'd make a cut to the budget and the mayor would just pull from revolving funds and fund the project regardless, things like this. And just the concept of revolving funds and some of these separate funds that we have no authority over. I don't think it's right for any money in the city to not have oversight. So we're hoping to change that.
So how would that get changed?
I think it would just be something like revolving funds having more oversight, being able to actually see how the money's spent and being able to approve or reject how that money's spent.
Okay.
Right now there's funds like, for example, the funds that make this cable channel exist. In theory, say we didn't like what was going on and made a cut, that money's coming from Comcast or it's coming from whatever cable company, so we actually can't even, we have almost no oversight over how that money's spent.
Okay. So there are a bunch of other things that could or could not be included,
yes.
Such as, especially with elections, making the voting age 16 instead of 18, allowing non-citizens to vote, allowing for a ranked choice voting system. Do any of those immediately strike you as positive or negative? Any of those hit home?
Yeah, well, I think non-citizen voting and teenage voting are both in the current proposal.
Okay.
And we've also passed several homeroom petitions to send to the state in support of those. They have not been approved. So I support both of those.
Have they been rejected or are they just...
They've been rejected.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, they've been sent to committee for... sent to study. So
okay, they're
when
sort
you,
of...
you send something to study, it basically means you've rejected it.
Yeah. Okay.
So they have not been approved, and I'm not hopeful that they will be approved again, but they are things that I support just because I think this is the lowest form of government that people have the most access to their elected officials and most impactful to people's day-to-day lives.
Yes.
So I'd like as many people impacted by our decisions as possible to be able to vote. And then ranked choice voting is one that we're studying ourselves. We promised to make a committee to study the possibility of making this happen. It's not in the current proposal, just because it's very complicated.
It is so complicated. Yeah. You think I mean, it sounds, what it is what it sounds like. You're making a first choice, a second choice, a third choice, and it eliminates the need for primaries or preliminaries because you're doing it all at once. But that isn't even a sufficient explanation, is it?
Yeah. Well, I always point out to people, I read, you know, ranked choice voting was on the ballot this past election, the governor's race, and it passed overwhelmingly in Somerville, but failed by the same overwhelming margin statewide. And when I read the ballot question to my wife and brother, I read the question verbatim and turned to them and said, now tell me what ranked choice voting is. And they couldn't explain it. So I think it's a very, it's an interesting idea. It works in other places. But I think in terms of we're trying to do all these things and ranked choice voting could be its own charter reform compared to everything else we're trying to do.
And it could save money too, right? Because it would eliminate the need for the...
It depends. I'd have to see numbers on that because, yes, we wouldn't have to do a primary, but a recount and actually counting the votes themselves would become more time-consuming. Hmm. Like Cambridge, it sometimes takes a couple days for them to figure out who won their election. So there's overtime hours in that. There's all sorts of issues that go with that.
Okay. So is there anything especially specific to Ward 1 that we haven't discussed yet that you get a lot of calls or emails or comments about in Ward 1?
Well, I think the number one issue is and has been rats as far as calls I get. So the city's investing a lot of money in addressing rodent issues. We have these new rodent zap boxes that we put around the city and has killed thousands of rodents. So that's the number.
In 6 months.
Yeah, in a very short period of time. So it looks like they're pretty effective. So I've asked for more to be allocated to East Somerville specifically. And I think in the new year, we're going to hopefully see that happen. Rodents is a big one. Traffic is another one. Just, you know, asking for the streets to be paved, new bike lanes, some people don't want the bike lanes, things like this. So those are the big issues.
What do you think about bike lanes?
I mean, I enjoy them as a bike rider. I think we need good balance in them, so I have to consider each street and whether it's a good use for a bike lane or not. So we have a lot of narrow streets. We got a lot of streets like Broadway and East Somerville that used to be a two-lane street that we narrowed to a one-lane street with a bike lane, and it's working great.
And there was that man who was killed on Broadway recently.
Yeah, that was the other side of Broadway, where they haven't had these changes. But yes, so you know, we need more bike lanes in the city, but we also need good balance in them because I think some streets, like right now, Pearl Street's the biggest one we're dealing with, where it's one of the oldest and longest streets in the city, and it's finally getting repaved, and we'd like to see a bike lane put there, but in the current configuration, to have the bike lanes and to have parking for people who don't have driveways, and to have it be a two-way street, and to widen the sidewalks. Like, there's all these considerations for each street, so we have to look at it from that perspective.
So, ending on that very complicated but thoughtful note, this has been City Council Spotlight. Have a good day.